Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to Trust and Believe. I'm your host, Shaun T. And of course, I'm very excited for you to be here today. But today is one of those days where we do a reverse interview where someone interviews me, one of your Fit Fam members. And this interview gets really deep. We talk about relationships. We talk about marriage. We also talk about the things that are happening in society right now and how we can somehow come together. It's going to be filled with fitness, fun, motivation, and a lot of tools that will help you be better in your family. So get ready to trust and believe.
Somebody say, oh yeah.
No. What's up?
He's better than Oprah. Come on, y'all.
This is Shaun T, and it's time to trust and believe. Renee, what's up?
Hi, how are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much for being here.
So good to be here. So exciting.
That's so exciting. Okay, so Renee, really quick before you start asking me questions, I want you to give just a really quick background on, you know, your journey, your baby's journey, your fitness journey, so people can know, you know, a little bit about you.
Okay, so obviously, like you said, I knew Scott when he played professional soccer in Buffalo and during our crazy wild times, and I met you because you came to my father's funeral. That was the first time I met you, which I've always thought was a very wonderful thing to do. We hadn't met yet, and that was the first time we met, and I got to know you, and saw what you brought into Scott's life. And so that was really special for me. And I just thought, man, if this person makes him happy, I'm going to be friends with him. Aww. Then I really figured out who you were as Shaun T. Because to me, you're Shaun Blocker, you know, my family member. And I have always wanted to be, like, I've always strived to be like that in that fit fam world. Like, I always, you know, my deep down, I wanted to do it, but I always had some doubts and whatever. And it took me a little while to really figure it out. And some of my questions here will dive into this that I have for you. But, you know, I started doing your workouts and I'll never forget, you know, my naivety, never say that word right. You know, in my mind, back in the day when your workouts were all on DVDs and stuff, I was always like, oh, he's probably got hundreds of them sitting in a back room somewhere. I'm going to have him give me one and I'm going to do it. Little did I know that is not actually the truth, but I was like, hey, I want to do rock and body or something. And you and Scott sent it to me and I realized, okay, this didn't come from his back room. This is sort of a long story. Then I had a conversation with Scott into which he said, I know your generosity. You don't mind giving this stuff to anybody, but you always said the person who invests in themselves gets more out of it. And I have thought about that probably for 10 years now. And every time you put out something, it's like I invest in myself, but with you as my trainer, but that meant a lot to me. I'm like, I know that if I put this in my investment in, and it's for me. And it's taken me a few years to figure that out, but I'm there now as far as fitness goes. I feel a little bit more part of that family, part of that. Like, I was always real hesitant in that way. We also connect in the fact that we both have twins. I have twin boys who are 7. And we struggled to get our boys as well. And we talked a lot during those years. And, you know, so those are kind of the things that are about me. There are 7 my boys are. I also have a 5-year-old daughter. They keep me busy and crazy.
And we are here now. Thank you so much for sharing. Okay.
Sorry,
so now that you all can connect with Renee a little bit, I am ready for my questions.
Okay. So the first one we're going to kind of start in what most people think about is, you know, your fitness level. So 2 years ago, I was lucky enough to get chosen by the Today Show to join you on the Transform 20 launch and do a 6-week program with you and go to New York and all the fun stuff. We were able to have dinner on the last time we were there, and you started talking to me about this idea you had for a new program. And you were asking my questions and thoughts about it, and you wanted to do a program for anybody could do. Didn't have to be the highest fitness level person, maybe someone who had a lot of weight to lose, someone who'd never worked out. Was that Let's Get Up? Was that your idea back then? Or did it evolve from something different?
It's so interesting you asked that. For so long, it's been since then. It must have been right since then because we had just finished Transform 20. But yes, I've always wanted to create something that was overall fitness. And while I have like the rocking bodies and the hip hop abs and the size, this was something where it didn't look so fitnessy to the point where people are like, okay, that's just another fitness workout. So that's why I really was happy to have like the dance portion, but it's also the toning portion. And it's also the insanity portion that's easier than the workout, the insanity workout itself. And there's days where you are just lifting weights. So I have really, really been striving to create something like this for a long time. And I'm so glad you asked that because last summer when I was actually having conversations with Beachbody, they asked me, what do you want to create? And I was like, I want to reach a different demographic of people and not just the person that needs to get off the couch. You know, they say get off the couch in quotes. For me, it's let's reach the person that doesn't really want to work out, or they worked out before, or they can't find consistency in working out because it's not fun. And so when they agreed to let me do this, and I was just super excited because I knew that I would show up on camera being 100% Shaun Blocker. And I'm so happy you said that earlier because, you know, Shaun T is Shaun T, but the person on that screen is actually Shaun Blocker. Like, I did not have to prepare to be anything except for, you know, make sure I knew my workouts before I got on stage. But usually before I do like a Transform 20, I go into this like meditative state and I'm like, or, you know, a max 30, and I have to be like, you know, I have to conjure up the energy because those workouts are so, so, so intense. Where this is like, I'm just, all right, let's just hang out. So yes, the answer to your question is yes. And I'm so happy you brought that up because I remember that day we were sitting at the Westin Hotel eating some good old food.
And so that's cool to see how that really transformed in 2 years, that you brought it to fruition. And you certainly can see your joy when you're on there, which kind of actually brings me to a question I was going to ask later. But since you talked about it, confidence, you exude confidence. So at what point did you just say, I am going to be Shaun T, unapologetically me? Was there like, did you grow into that? Was there just a defining moment that was like, I don't care what other people think or say?
Yeah, you know, thank you. The seed was planted a very long time ago. And like anything else, my confidence grew just like a tree would grow, right? But for me, and a lot of people who have read my book, it happened on the night that I moved out of my house and I moved into my grandparents' house. I actually felt so free. I was just away from toxicity. And I just remember, for the first 14 years of my life, I wasn't truly enjoying life. Like, I wasn't living. Like, birthdays, holidays, it was just, I just used to ask myself, why are people so excited? Because I was so miserable. And then once I turned 14 and I started to go to high school, I just remember not giving a bleep. I was just like, I spent my entire life not being who I am. And then I just like slowly worked into me kind of being me, to where I was 16 years old. And the first person that I told that I was gay was myself, you know. And then once I did that, I started to accept myself a little more. I started to really excel in sports because I just started to like push away anything that could hold me back. And then it just really, really, really grew from there. And I think that each time, you know, I reach, or we all reach a different point in our lives, there's still something that can kind of like hinder your confidence in different areas, especially as you age, right? You know, but yeah. Then I always go back to, well, I'm not going to hide myself. And social media has this entire, while it's really great to connect, it's also extremely horrible for people to have to like fake who they are. And even as a fitness motivator, if you will, there are times where you're like, oh, I'm this kind of trainer. And then you're like, I want to be that. And then you're like, oh, I'm this kind of trainer. And I'm just like, no. Whereas now, if you follow my Instagram, I'm like, it's not that I'm a fitness trainer or a fitness guru. It's that I am me, and it's just, this is just what you get. And if you don't want to be a part of it, I am so fine with it. I'm like completely fine with it because I started to realize that the people who want to be around you are the people that accept your confidence, right? There's like, there are plenty of celebrities out there. And even like somebody like a Beyonce who like the world loves, there are people that's like, eh, she's not for me, but that doesn't stop her from being her. And I think that when we stop ourselves from being ourselves for someone else, who's going to walk away, they're going to eat, they're going to sleep, they're not going to care about you, and we hinder ourselves because of what other people think about us, it's like the craziest thing to me. And so I was like, well, as long as I'm being a good person and I'm being myself, then that's the only thing I can give you.
And that's definitely a hard thing. I still struggle with that part, but you actually answered a couple more of my questions. But is there anything that you would change about yourself, or that you are striving to change, that, you know, maybe you don't like about yourself?
Oh, this is tough. So I'm going to work through this question. I'm going to work through this answer, I should say. I used to hate my face. I used to hate my face. And people who have read my book, they know, like, I always used to feel like my face was like really fat and I had these big cheeks because I was always still looking at the person that was 50 pounds overweight. But now I love my face. I'm like, bitch, I'm fine. You know, like, it's, you know, so that was something I struggled with for a while. I used to struggle with the stretch marks on my butt. I know that's like a lot. Like, I used to really hate that about myself because I gained a lot of weight really quickly. Until I was just, and now I don't even really see them anymore necessarily, meaning like they don't carry a lot of weight with me. And I don't really know now if there's something I don't like about myself, because it was also my patience. Like, I hated how impatient I was. And it's so interesting you asked that question, because I came downstairs today because, you know, we're living with Scott's mom and dad. You know, I look at Bill and like, Bill don't give a fuck. Like, he does not. Bill is like, this is me. And I would always be like, wow, like, how does he have that, you know, zero fucks attitude, if you will, but not in a mean way, like he's better than anybody else. Right. Just so, I was actually walking to the trash can today to put something in the trash this morning. And, you know, I just started to think, you know, I'm gonna be 43 in about 10 days or so. And I was just kind of like, wow, I really am starting to not really care what people think about me. And a lot of it has to do with knowing Bill over the last 10 years. Cause I used to actually be like, there's no way you could not care. There's no way. You know, I used to be like, but I'm around him a lot. And he's like, well, you know, if I hurt someone's feelings, or if someone's sad, or if something I did, or they interpreted something the wrong way, he's like, absolutely, I care. But he said, in terms of who I am, you know, it's like, I've been on this earth for 78 years, you know, and this is, you know, I've learned to grow into me. So it's really fun to kind of do that. So I don't really think there's anything I don't like about myself at the moment. At the moment.
It always evolves.
It could always evolve into something that I don't know about.
And everyone needs a little Bill Blocker in their life, and that,
exactly.
Stuff, so, yeah. Okay. Let's talk about relationships a little bit.
Ooh.
First, your professional relationships. You have a great team around you. You know, you have been able to maintain longevity with people. People want to be around you. So how do you cultivate lasting relationships in business? Even with, say, the Beachbody family themselves, because you've had a long-standing relationship, can't have always been good, you know, mm-hmm. but you've maintained their respect, and with, whether it's with Carl Deichler or the other trainers, but also your core people.
Yeah. So one of the first thing for me is I try to just create good energy with people. And I think that's just the first thing. Like, if, you know, actually Chip said this to me a couple months ago, how he loved, cause I was like, you know, I think I asked him something like, do you like your job, or do you like coming to work? Like, I'm totally fine if you say no, you know, cause I'm just like, and he was saying how, you know, he just really enjoys it because he's like, you're always exciting and happy. And like, even when I'm stressed, like I still carry good energy. And so that's, for me, it's about the energy you provide to people. But more importantly than that, I really take a proactive approach on looking up to the people that work with me. Like I'm always learning from someone. You know, we hired Alex when she was very young. And mm-hmm. even at that moment, instead of looking at her at the time as like my assistant, I'm just like, well, you know, there were times where I was like, wow, like she's such a socialite and she has style and personality. And maybe she didn't even know all this about herself. But as she has grown, like I've always been like, oh, what can I learn from her? What can I learn from her? Even with Scott as my spouse, you know, I try to make him my boss because I have to really put people. Scott says he hates when he puts people on a pedestal, but me, I actually really like it, especially if they're on Team Shaun T, because it keeps me looking at them for things and not being like, well, I'm the boss and do as I say, you know. And obviously we have Chip and Elliot now, and I let people run with their expertise, you know, and really try to guide that way. And I think that, you know, we've had minimal issues in terms of, you know, our team now, but there has been times in the building of my team with people who aren't here anymore that were an absolute nightmare and people who didn't work out. So it doesn't always work out. But I never like to badmouth people when they're not a part of the team, because I'm just like, for what? And first of all, none of us are perfect anyway, so it is what it is. But so it's not all sunshine and rainbows, but it's definitely, I definitely try to carry the energy to really kind of keep people uplifted, keep their spirits high. And everybody will tell you, I tell everyone that's ever worked for me, I'm like, if there's a point where you don't want to work for me anymore, I'm really not going to be offended. And the reason why is because I didn't get here where I am by just having one job or not like progressing in my life. So, I mean, I could be wrong, but I also feel like my team feels the freedom to, you know, do things that they love, still have their passions, because I think it helps people grow. I mean, I got a side hustle, you know, so I really encourage people to even if you're working with me or for me, if you will, continue to do the things. As far as Beachbody goes, it's a little bit different because I'm contracted into that company. And I think that I've lasted a really long time, and maybe other people haven't, is obviously for many reasons and people's own personal, you know, stories and relationships. But for me, even when times weren't great in terms of like the relationship, because you know, every relationship has its ups and downs. Yep. For me, I always go back to why I did it. And that really saves a lot. I'm just like, I do it for the people. There was one time where I left a shoot and I was like, I'm never doing this again. It was just like, it was a nightmare. I was super stressed. I could not wait to leave that shoot. I was just like extremely overwhelmed. It just became too much. And I remember walking away being like, I'm never doing this again. I was like, I'm never doing this again. And then I realized that it's just that I needed a break and I needed to find my own growth in order to get back in front of the camera. And so by working on yourself and continuing to work on myself, you know, I found my love to be in front of the camera again. And I think that for me, especially with my team, I try not to keep it bored and boring. I try to like keep it lively. It's been really tough with the pandemic, obviously, but we love to go on international trips. You know, I love to go with my team to amusement parks, like things that don't necessarily, you don't need to for work, but yeah. It's just to keep the energy high and keep that playful spirit. And but now in terms of going back to Beachbody, you know, I think that there's like this incredible trust that they have in me and vice versa. Mm-hmm. And I think not for the first time, I know that they have always appreciated me, appreciated my talent, appreciated my delivery and what I bring to the table. But I think now they see the depth of who I am and how I can really help impact not just my workouts, but just the company in general in a really good way. So I think it's super fun and it's great and I'm having a good time and I get to put out new content and, you know, but like I said, there's definitely roller coaster rides with every relationship.
I know I'm biased, but they're lucky to have you. And there's a lot of people out there who are inspired by you, as you already know, and whatever. And it's funny because I know you, obviously, and you like things a certain way, but yet it just seems like you also give your people, you're not a micromanager of individuals and their creativity and what they bring, which as someone who works for people and has people under me, that's, you know, a good leadership skill to have. So
thank you. You know, I despise when I would work for somebody that was like overlooking over my shoulder. And there is a balance, right? There is the balance of, because sometimes not being a micromanager, you sometimes don't give enough information to. But for mm-hmm. me, freedom is really important. And I'd rather somebody feel really free than feel constricted to actually come with all of who they are. So thank you so much.
Okay, so next relationship with Scott. I've obviously been privy enough to be around you guys since the beginning, since he literally called me in my office and said, I need you to go on the computer and look up Shaun T. And I'm like, what? And I looked him up and I'm like the hip hop abs guy? That was exactly the conversation we had. And that's how he told me who he was dating. And then from there on. So
funny.
Okay, so I saw you bring out a different confidence in him that he didn't have necessarily, especially about himself. And as his friends, you know, we certainly worried about that, but you brought that out in him and his ability to be like, screw you, I am who I am. And so you guys are couple goals to a lot of people, but also not perfect and never perfect. So what would you say to someone who's two are in a relationship and both people are definitely different sides of the spectrum, but how do you bring out the best in your spouse and them, you?
You actually have to admit what they're better at than you. I think when you start to do that, you argue less. I know Scott is better at managing finances and he is way more patient and super nice. And all three of those things used to piss me the fuck off. Like I used to be like, how can you be that nice? Like I want to argue, you know? And like, I would be like, I don't, you know, why do I have to save this, you know, money or it's the patience and stuff like that. And it's just that we are all so fixed in our ways that the thing that actually makes us opposite of our spouse, I bet you everybody can be like, oh, well, that's what we argue about most. Like some, you know, so I, and then what you do, I'll talk about the mistakes you make. And he does the same thing. And what we would do sometimes, especially in like those heated moments, is we would try to change who the other person is instead of trying to understand that that's what they're, number one, that's who they are. And number two, you're just mad because, you know, he's more patient than you. This is what I say to myself. Well, you're just mad because he knows how to spend money better than you. You know, you're just mad because, you know, he's nicer than you. You know, and I know a lot of people think I'm nice, but or whatever. I'm a nice person, but, you know, in those situations. And he would look at me and look at my confidence, you know, and feel like I was being mean or like I didn't have a care because I'm so confident. So you actually fight against what the other person is just really good at and who they are instead of saying, can you teach me how to be like that? Like if you can actually go to your spouse and say, can you teach me how to be like that? Instead of being like, why are you like that? It took us a long time to get there. You know, generally we're best friends, right? Like we love everything from sports to traveling. You know, our intimate life is incredible. You know, we have all these really great ways of connecting or whatever, but they are three areas, at least from me to him, I had to like admit some of these things. I'm like, well, you're just mad because you don't have it together like that, you know? And so I'm just like, okay, well, can you teach me? You know what I mean?
That's so good because...
But it's hard.
Same thing.
But it's so hard, right? It's so hard to say you're more patient than me. It's extremely hard to do that because you're insecure about that, or that's some of the reasons why you failed. And so with Scott specifically, and they're just three examples, I can give you more. But I know Scott used to, one of the things from his end is he used to always try to fix me. And he used to be like, I'm going to fix it. And I'm like, don't fix me. And the reason why I don't want to be fixed is because I actually like finding my way through the maze. And he struggled so much with finding his way to being comfortable being gay. Whereas me, I strive through struggle. I'm like, put me in the hardest maze. And so we used to really butt heads about that, because I'm like, no, like, let me do the struggle and you can't fix me. You know, so we just had these like really, I mean, it'll be in 2022, it'll be 10 years of marriage, 12 years together. And so whilst for some people that might not be a lot, for us, it is a lot, because whereas a lot of spouses, they wake up in the morning, they go to work for, you know, 8-10 hours a day, they come home and they have weekends together. Scott and I are pretty much together 24 hours a day. So our 12 years coming up is going to be literally like 24 years of being together. When you compare it to other couples. So anyway, that's a really great question. And no one's actually ever asked me that before.
Yeah, good. Well, you know, Bill and I are in the same, we're 11 years. So we kind of follow the same path, and we have enjoyed wine nights on Friday together. It's definitely brought us some conversations where we're like, they just talked about that. And we're like, all right, let's dive into that. Get the wine, get the alcohol, and let's dive into
Yeah, I just need a little something to drink before we go all the way in.
Which is funny, even with your spouse, you kind of got to like loosen up a little bit.
Yeah, like, okay.
After the things we've been through for fertility and stuff, you'd think it would be easy, but sometimes it's not.
Yes.
Okay. Relationships a little bit with the boys. So parenting twins brings about a very different thing. I mean, yes, you can parent two children, but twins just, they has a different level of stuff. Mm. So just describe your relationship with each of the boys, with Sander and Silas, and how is each the same and each of those relationships different?
Oh my gosh, that is such a great question. Never asked before. And it's so great to get it from a twin parent. So I'll start with my relationship with Silas. He is like literally the most loving human being, but like he is King Kong trapped into a three-year-old's body. So here's the interesting thing. So he and my relationship, like, so when I leave in the morning, like he gives everyone a kiss when they leave. But a lot of times, like if I leave in the morning before, you know, his teachers or nannies get there, like he'll walk me to the door and he'll stand at the door and see me go. And he will, there have been times where he literally like cries his eyes out, you know, if I drive off in a car. Mm-hmm. And it's because this is going to sound really weird to some people, but you know, we had our kids obviously via surrogacy, and Scott and I fertilized eggs or whatever. I think a lot of people know that. And my connection to Silas is very similar to my connection with Scott. It is like, cause Silas is a wild, crazy boy, but he has Scott's like unbelievably like sweet demeanor, like very thoughtful, extremely caring. And you know, he will stand there sometimes, like if I'm thinking of something, and he'll be like, what are you thinking about, Papa? Like he's very, you know, so my relationship with him is, it's very similar to Scott, but I'm also the person where, you know, he has amazing nannies and he's really rough with them. And they're like, you know, don't be so rough. And then he comes up to me, he's really rough with me, and they tell him not to be rough. And I'm like, no, it's fine. Like our relationship is wrestling, and like, I throw him around and it's just like, you know, it's just that, but he will always be my baby. Like now I know why parents say, Mom, I even texted my mom yesterday and I said, do you still consider me to be your baby boy? And she called me up right away. She was like, you will always be my baby boy. Mm-hmm. And it's different with Sander, which I'll talk about in a second, but Silas will always be my baby boy. I don't care when he's 40 and I'm 79 years old. I just know that I will never forget that face, and like just our connection is just crazy. Even when, you know, I remember one time he was really sick and, you know, I picked him up and I was like, you know, rubbing his back. He said, he just looked at me like, Papa, can you make me feel better? And it's like when he's scared or when he's really sick, like I'm the one he comes to. So so that's my connection with Silas. Sander is different. Sander is like, he's like enamored by me. I think he sees me in himself or vice versa. You know, he sees, cause he loves to dance. And if he's dancing and I turn and watch him, he does this thing with his face. He goes like, cause he doesn't want me to like, look at him. He loves singing. Yeah. He acts like me, you know, he wants his hair like me. He sits in my lap all, like I can't even eat my dinner. So he, like, I think he kind of sees me in him. And then the connection is just like that. Both of the boys, when they run in the room in the morning, you know, they, good morning, Papa, you know, and I'm like, go say hi to Dada, because I'm also more of that, I'm the stern parent, you know, I'm very much like, I'm not taking no shit, where Scott takes a little more shit, just a little bit. but back to my relationship with Sander, he's very, I don't know, like he's very, he's like an old soul and he's very eccentric. Like this week he has had rainbow hair. Like his nanny puts in like weaves in his hair and he has rainbow hair and he wants to paint his nails and he wants to, you know, even when he builds with his toys, like it's very colorful and he asks 20,000 questions a day. And I never, ever, 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 ever not answer any of them. I answer every single one of them with complete sentences. It's like, he's like, Papa, why are you doing that? I'm doing that because, and he'll ask why. So, but that's my individual relationships with the boys. And then I think the one thing that is that connects the two is I love being their teacher. I love reading to them. I really make sure they know how to behave and listen. And while they don't do it with us all the time, when you see them go to swim and gymnastics, you could tell that they, you want to use the word trained, but you know, they have good home training, if you will.
Absolutely.
And yeah, I mean, it's just, but I'm also like, I love to play with them. Like I'm the one that's like, let's go to an amusement park. Let's, you know, let's do the fun type of thing. And Scott's like, oh, he's like, okay, like, well, let's go. But I'm the crazy parent with both of them.
It has been fun watching you and Scott with them, just because my boys are just a couple years older, so I get to kind of relive some of those things.
Oh, my goodness. I'm going to be calling you soon about what to expect, because I know that it's going to be coming up soon where they're going to start to get super independent, and because it's already happening. They still love sitting on my lap, but I just know that there's going to be a day, and I'm just going to be like, when they stop wanting to sit on my lap.
They don't want anything to do with you, but they're still always going to want you in those private times when nobody else is around. They're still going to want you. Is there something that you think parents are doing in today's day and age that are screwing kids up?
That's a really good question and hard for me to answer, because I think we all screw things up. You know, I said to Scott, I don't care how great we are as we think we are as parents, or how many amazing compliments we get from our Fit Fam and people who follow us on social media. I'm like, our boys are still going to need therapy. Every single one of us will. They will. I mean, they are growing up in a two parent household. Both are dads, you know, living with the grandparents and moving homes. And Scott and I, in some ways, have two different parenting styles. And I just know that no matter, our intention is to raise them. Our intention is to make them the best that they can be. But they also receive that in a different way. And they look at us however they look at us. And so, you know, I can't say whether a parent is raising their kid right or wrong. But what I can say is, and this is the thing that I think is most important, is even if you're doing the best you can do, it's not perfect. So try to do the best that you can do. Like, instead of messing up to mess up, like, don't compound the F up, you know, in parenting. Do the best that you can do, because it's still going to require more work later in life. And I think that's just the thing, is don't exacerbate what's already going to happen. And I know I don't want that to sound negative, because there are probably people out there that's like, my kid's on a schedule. They eat vegetables. You know, they get straight A's in school. Well, I know plenty of people. Like, one of my friends said as a child, he never had any issues with his parents. His parents even got a divorce. And he was like, oh my gosh, like, I just had this incredible childhood. And then he told me last year, he said, but I had no idea how to deal with conflict when I got older. He's like, I have no idea how to deal with conflict because I never saw it. And so, you know, I tell parents, be the best parent you can be, but even the best of parents, in quotes, that never argue, that never do this, their kid's going to have to learn something. It's going to affect them some way. So as long as we're doing the best we can do, we minimize the amount of therapy they're going to need later.
Everybody deserves a good therapist.
Exactly.
Okay. So this one kind of might be deep. I hope it's okay. It's sort of about what's going on in the world right now. Mm-hmm. My boys are blonde-haired, blue-eyed, Irish-skinned boys. Yours are brown-skinned, dark-haired cuties. 15 years from now, what could I be saying as the mom to my boys now to teach them? What would you want me to be teaching them so that in 15 years, when our four boys are out, about, hanging out, they might not have to deal with quite what's going on? Because I'm clearly having to tell my boys different things than you may be having to tell yours. And I'm so bothered by that over the last year, but I know it's true.
Yeah.
So like, what would you want me to say to my boys?
First of all, that is a really great question. And two other things. One, I think it's really brave of you to ask that question. And I also think it's could be in some ways vulnerable, because here's the thing I'll say. I know you. I know you're not a racist person. I know you're extremely open-minded. But what happens in some of these households that are extremely open-minded, not racist, you know, whatever, is that because life is good for them, they don't feel like they have to deliver these messages to their children. Don't talk to the kids about that. Like, they don't need to know what's going on. Yes, they do. My kids knew what a pandemic was immediately when a pandemic, we told them everything about it. And so I think the biggest mistake people make is, well, our house is fine and we're accepting of everyone, but okay, that's fine. But just like the other day, Sander was at the park and a little boy didn't want to play with him because he looked different. They're like, he looks different than me. Now for me, I could say, but the, you know, he heard that at home, but at the same time, he may not have heard it at home. His parents may have, they may not be in any way racist, but they didn't say, hey, when you leave the house, you're going to experience so many different types of people and this is who they are and love them. And everybody's created equal. And if, you know, whatever. And so for me, it's just, I don't want to say educate your children. It's more of like, help them understand that there's so many different types of people, places, things in the world. Travel if you can, I know, with the pandemic. But, you know, when Sander asked if he could paint his nails rainbow, I immediately said, oh, and I'll do it with you. And can I have rainbow hair? Absolutely. And there was one time Silas saw on one of, you know, those iPads, they have all kinds of crazy shows. And even if it's a kid show, And he said one day, he said, a little boy was wearing a pink or something. He's like, pink is for girls. And I was like, no, it's not. And I had to sit him down. I was like, little boys can wear pink. Girls can wear blue. Boys can put a wig on. Like, boys can wear a dress if they want to. And guess what? Silas ended up being a witch for Halloween and wearing a dress. And when we went to Ross, he wanted pink shoes, because I nipped it in the bud right away. I was like, that doesn't exist, buddy. I was like, it doesn't exist. And I said, some people have two moms. Some people have two dads. Some people are taken care of by their grandparents. Some people have one mom. Some people I tell them this a lot, so that when they do go out into the world, they're not going to be like, oh my God, that person is different. They're just going to be like, hey, you know? And so, actually, I have two tennis coaches now, and one of my tennis coaches, he's 27 or 28. He's like, very all-American guy. And we just started talking one day, and I was like floored to know that his parents raised him. He's like, how we're talking about. He's like, I don't care if you're gay. I don't care if you're trans. Like, if you want to hit with me, I'm going to hit with you. And I just think that parents should just really not just let it fall by the wayside and expect, just because they may be and have certain views and accept everyone, that their kids know. Like, it's okay to talk to your kids about these things no matter how young they are.
That's so good, because I do feel like that's where, like you said, you know me, we have these things, but I always was like, we accept everybody, so let's just leave it at that. And I've learned certainly that, you know, well, let's talk about it. And my boys see you and Scott and the boys, and it's just Uncle Scott and Uncle Shaun, and it's Sander and Silas. And I'm glad for that, but I still feel like I have to educate them on some things and,
yeah, and I also
trying to
think,
say the right thing.
I also think that I want to tell people out there, it's okay to say to your kid, if they're white, to be like, these are Black kids. You don't have to say they're African American. No, these are the Black kids. Don't tell me you don't see color. Because kids will see, they will know what's different. So it's just like, these are the Black kids, these are white kids, this person is Latin. You know, that person, if they have a Black mom and a white dad and they're in school, and it's like, they're like, oh, why does that person have curly hair? Why do they look different? Oh, one of their parents is Black and one of their parents is white. And when they make a baby, you know, that this is the, like, I think it's like, why hide it from them? Let them understand. Like, yep. Kids are sponges and they don't judge unless they hear it.
Yeah, that's so good. Because I do think, as sometimes in someone like me, we are afraid to say those things for saying the wrong thing. But people who are true and their heart is real should be able to say that. And, you know, my kids come home and they're like, they'll say, oh, Joey. And I'm like, oh, what about Joey? And he'll be like, well, he's got brown skin. Okay, let's talk about Joey and what you guys did and how he's your friend or whatever the case may
exactly.
be. So I'm kind of opening that up a little bit. So anyways, that's, you know, it's kind of a tough, it shouldn't be as tough to talk about, but I mean, it's definitely been, obviously, with everything going on in yes. our world. I just have a couple fun questions.
Okay.
If you could take over anybody's social media for the day, whose would it be and why? And what would you do?
Oh, man, that is a great question. I would probably say it would be Serena Williams' social media, because I would literally tease her the entire time, because she's a big jokester. She is like the absolute worst when it comes to pranking people and teasing people. I remember one time I was playing tennis against her, and she hit the ball three times as hard as she could at me. And like later that night, she was like, I'm sorry. I was like, don't worry about it. I'm gonna get you back, you know? So I would love to do some tennis. I would love to, like, you know, model her clothes, even if it was like a dress just for fun. Like, I just think it'd be so fun and she loves Disney and, you know, just dance to Disney songs and invite Venus over. I don't know. I just think it'd be really fun to do. And then also, I would love to, obviously, even though I've done it before, get another tennis lesson with her coach, Patrick Mouratoglou, because hello, yeah. you know, if you're Serena Williams, you get yeah. the best of the best in tennis. So
yeah.
it would definitely be Serena. And I think it would be absolutely hilarious.
That would be fun. That would be funny. What would the theme song of your life be if you picked one?
It's so funny. I don't, it's tough to pick one at the moment, but I think it would be, and the reason why I'm saying this song is because when I was doing my Shaun T Transforms America tour, when my book came out, like, this song I play all the time. And the song is This Is the Life by Fifth Harmony, you know, because I just believe, like, at every moment, I think most people want to enjoy their life, and they want to be like, they want to feel joy and they want to feel freedom about their life. And that song, like, when the beat comes in and at the end of the day, like, this is the life. And it really pushes me to really enjoy what I'm doing at this moment.
When live events return, is Buffalo going to be on the calendar?
I'm thinking that after 11 years of knowing you, 12 years of knowing you, I think it's time to get Buffalo on the calendar.
give us a chance. I have a contingent of people. You will not be disappointed.
I know.
I'm doing an event here.
I definitely know I won't be disappointed doing an event with you. Yeah. I think it'll be really great. And yeah, I can't wait. Renee, thank you so much. This is so fun. You asked really great questions that I've never gotten before. And hopefully everyone...
Thank you. I was trying to be different.
Of course. And hopefully everyone out there, I hope you enjoyed. And even with some of the tough questions and questions about the world and children, I think that it will help you grow and trust and believe a little bit more in who you are and your family.